I'm Van.
I'm Sori.
That's Booby.
And Vita and Chip. Oh.
Vita's up and kicking?
Well, yeah, but we left her on all night. We forgot to turn her off again.
Unbelievable. But very believable. Yeah. This is our life, ladies and gentlemen.
Speaking of our life, if you want to see more behind the scenes with us, check out my channel, My Sori Life.
If you want to hear timely, topical, political, / religious, / sociological discussions, you can check out my channel at Middle America with Vin and Sori.
Yep.
Yeah, I mean, we really covered all the bases. We covered immunizations, religion, and the last fireside. Yep. Shout out to the big homie Ian. That boy was, he came with his data.
He was ready. Like,
as of 1948.
I was like, wow.
Like, ooh, okay. It was done.
Yeah.
Like, there were a couple people in the chat that were like, you know, they're not fans of immunizations, but the way Ian presented that data, they didn't want no parts. They didn't want no parts of that man. Mm. MDeath fan, tell the truth, bruh. I can call him out because he's not a snowflake, but they didn't want no parts of Ian. Anyway,
he definitely studied that through.
So Middle America has been in Sori. So it's you know, there's a lot of channels that do politics and stuff like that, but it's like kind of like a monologue. The format of the Middle America channel is I do little 5-10 minute monologues, and then we do a fireside on those topics.
Yep.
Do a fireside every 48 to 72 hours. So there you are. All right. Beyond the Realms of Death, Judas Priest. A lot of people have been asking us to do this song ever since we did Priest.
Mm-hmm.
We kind of got away from Priest.
Mm, yeah.
I think it was, you know, a lot of
nobody's
Iron...
Nobody's asking for it on the website.
Well,
either.
I mean, once you do Iron Maiden, then people, all the Maiden fans, so hopefully we can get back to Priest. We've had a very interesting relationship with the big homie.
I know, yep. You should check out our journey on that.
Yeah. Speaking of which, happy belated birthday to the big homie Azul Faro.
Happy birthday!
Azul, I think that's how...
I wish, you know, like when you send a text message and it says right. Happy birthday and all the balloons and confetti can go up? Just imagine that's happening over the screen.
Shout out to the big homie. We got a present coming for you on the way.
Be ready.
Okay. Beyond the Realms of Death, Judas Priest. Let's do it.
Okay. Well, I expect you to just go there. Start. And go.
Oh boy.
Goodbye. And then he died. Out of the world.
feel like, so I didn't come up in the guitar solo
realm
era in metal, right? Yep. So going back and listening to bands that had, you know, guitar solos, mm-hmm. like, I feel like a lot of them were like, you, first of all, you had to have one. Mm-hmm. You had to have a guitar solo. And then, so then
it would
it's
be
like
tough to force that.
Yeah, like every song, yeah. It's like, oh, but the solos on this one was like perfect. Mm-hmm. Like it matched it perfectly.
Yep.
With the tempo and the sound, and I love when they like.
Oh, me too. I love that sound. Yeah.
So it's like, I feel like it's like one in a million where you know, on any given metal record, back
put
in
out
the day,
a good solo.
When the it's tricky because it's not that the solos weren't good back in the day. Like we hear a lot of solos because we listen to mm-hmm. old school. It's not that. It's just. Okay, first of all, my favorite solo of all time is the Fade to Black solo mm-hmm. at the end of that song because it fit perfectly with the song. That's my question, is like, does the solo fit perfectly? Is the song the same without the solo?
Yeah.
Or could the song pass without yep. the solo? And that the solo on Fade to Black, I don't think it passes without mm-hmm. without that song. Mm-hmm. So or without the solo. Where this one is like similar to me, like obviously not on the level of Fade to Black for me personally, mm-hmm. but I do think that both the solos were really good and it fit with the song. It wasn't mm-hmm. just that it was good, mm-hmm. but it fit with the song, and there'd be something missing for the song if you didn't have the solo.
If it wasn't there, yeah. Yeah, I hear you.
So I mean, I've even heard solos from Judas Priest where I was like, oh, okay. All right. You know, but this one, it's like, okay, this belonged on the song.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I liked that long part where it was just like stretched out really, really long.
Mm-hmm.
I like that part.
Okay, so this is...
This one I thought was sad. It was sad content, though.
Yeah. So Painkiller, I guess the Painkiller record was, they got taken to court. Because I guess a kid killed himself after listening to their music. So I'm probably completely butchering this. But I'm wondering if this was the song that they were listening to when, you know, whatever. I mean, it couldn't be because this record was done in 1978 and Painkiller, I checked, was from 1990.
Okay.
It's like a 12-year gap, so.
Well.
But I mean, I could see somebody.
Why? Do you think that the person killed themselves in the end?
I don't really know. I mean, he dies.
They just died.
But he keeps saying, it's my life, I'll decide, not you. So yeah. That leads me to believe that it's possible.
Yeah, I see what you're saying.
But I mean, it could be that he just passed away into whatever. But
I just thought that it was like, you know, you have the story about this person that closes themselves off to the world and just kind of like, I don't know, encircles
into some
themselves
sort of
in
catatonic
their own
state.
Yeah, in their own mind.
Yeah.
And then they're not engaging with the world around them, and you can do that, and he, you know, he's saying like, it's safe here in my mind, I'm free to speak with my own kind, which is, it's only you that's there, like,
right,
you know, and then this is my life, I'll decide, not you. But then what ends up happening is withdrawn, he'd sit there stare blank into space, no sign of life would flicker on his face, until one day he smiled, it seemed as though with pride, the wind kissed him goodbye, and then he died. So like, his whole life, it's just like, he pulls in, he blanks out, and like, the world is going on around him, but he's so in, like, in his own mind that he misses all of that. And then like, he has this smile, which I guess could be, yeah, he has like this thought of like, oh, okay, now this is the day I'm gonna end myself. Or it's just that he, you know, he smiled and then he goes off and he dies. But when I heard that part, I thought, like, remember that story about the person that has the golden ball with the silver string and they keep pulling it to push time forward? And like, every time that the kid gets in a situation he doesn't like, he pulls a string and it pushes it forward until finally he's at the end of his life. He wasted it all by pulling this string.
Right.
You know, and so like, this person, I thought the same thing. Like, yeah, you pulled into yourself and you surrounded yourself with yourself, but then in the end, that's all you had, you know? Like, there's so much that this person missed on. And to me, it was really sad because, like, he said something like, oh, right, keep the world with all its sin. It's not fit for living in. Yeah, I will start again. It can take forever and ever, but I shall win. And, like, that's a... There is a lot in this world that can make you feel, like, cold inside. Because there's a lot of, you know, like... You know, when you see people kicking over water jugs at the border, or you see, you know, a serial killer and what he's done to people, or you hear about a child that's been molested, or, you know, like, when you just hear, like, horror after horror of things that human beings are capable of, it can be a bit daunting. But then when you stop and you see there's beauty there too, and so right. This guy missed out. It's not just a horrible place to be. Like, that's not all the world is. There's right. also goodness, and we've seen... I mean, even in our own, you know, even in our own channel, you know, like, there's Pony the other night. She wants to give away a shirt to somebody. You know what I mean? Like,
right.
Here's people that none of us, I don't know. Maybe some of us are rich. I don't know if there's some people that watch this that actually have, like, more than just
well,
what they need.
Well, I know for a fact that Pony's not rich.
Right. But I'm saying, like, most of us are just, we're just normal people, you know.
Everybody's pushing,
trying to, yeah. And then, like, to find, like, spaces in there to do good for other people or to take care of other people and, you know.
Well, yeah, because she had just gotten a you know, run into some financial blessing or whatever because of the holidays.
Yep.
And instead of ordering it for herself, immediately it goes back out to somebody else.
Yeah. And there's stuff like that all over the place where people are doing something for somebody else and helping other people.
Well, that's...
So, it's not all bad.
I'm not mentioning the actual show we're watching, because I don't want anybody to throw any spoilers out there, but we're watching this show about a dystopian reality, and that's one of the themes of the show, which is at what point does life become not worth living?
Yeah.
And there's all these different scenarios about people choosing to exit the planet on their terms, their way. And then there's the whole other one where can you bring a baby into this situation because, you know, of how horrifying the world that they have to inhabit is. And their world is extremely horrifying. That's the genre.
Right.
But then there's other elements that are saying no, and we need to fight for each other, and there are good things, and then there's still deer out in the world, and kids, and blah, 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 blah. And so, like, there's this whole back and forth dialogue of you know, the will to live and trying to justify existence, which Jordan Peterson talks about, like, the... existence being a hell of a thing and a terrible burden that all of us have to bear at some point. But I can definitely see a kid listening to this at 16, 17 years old and being in a bad state of mind, and then bang.
Yeah.
They're out of here.
Yeah.
But this guy seems to think that if he leaves this world, that there's going to be another world where he won't have to deal with sin.
Yeah, but he's saying, I don't even know how long it's going to be, but... Like,
it can take forever and ever and ever, but I shall win. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna make it. I'm not gonna have to deal with the overwhelming nature of the sinfulness of human beings. Because I can't. Yeah, I mean, it just depends on what you want to focus on.
Yeah.
You know, it really does. And of course, our worldview is extremely convenient, like I always say, because there is the... There's a lot of context around why things are the way that they are, because everybody has a certain, you know, it's kind of like if I was a fish and I was swimming, I would have no desire for dry land, because that's what you were created for.
Right.
You're created to live in dry land, so there would be no sense that something is wrong.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But when you're... All of us have this collective sense that something is wrong, and that tells me. So then you look at Christianity, you go, this is a solution, this is wishful thinking. So the one way to look at Christianity is say, it's all big wishful thinking, and it's just a way to escape from the harsh reality of the world. Okay, right, I agree, that's one way to look at it. Another way to look at it is to say, well, maybe the fact that all of us collectively, no matter where you are on the planet or what time period you're in, all of us collectively know that something is wrong, maybe that indicates that there was an original right.
Right. Yeah.
Maybe the fact that we all know that things are not the way that they're supposed to be indicates that there was a time when things were the way they were supposed to be. Mm-hmm. And then I say to myself, okay, well, what narrative tells us that, explains where we are now, and mm-hmm. gives some sort of solid hope for the future? And obviously, right. I'd say that our narrative does. Mm-hmm. Everything was perfect. There was no sin that this guy's complaining about. We screwed it up because of human selfishness. Mm-hmm. And it's going to be fixed again for everybody who wants to be part of the new world. Mm-hmm. Because the solution to human selfishness is to worship God. Like that. Okay. That's the narrative that we're operating in. And, of course, I believe it's the 100% absolute truth. But even if you didn't believe that, you have to admit that carries a ton of utility.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because it kind of stabilizes you. Because I think what happens to a lot of people, and I think it happens on steroids now because of how we're able to almost be omniscient observers mm-hmm. of human depravity. Mm-hmm. I think there comes a time in everybody's life when they really kind of hit that point where they're like, damn, people are evil as hell. I always talk about it was when yep. was the Holocaust.
Yep.
You know, the Holocaust for me was when I really learned about that kind of, you lose something and you're like, whoa. Mm-hmm. And I think everybody kind of has that moment. Yeah. A lot of people in the previous generation, it was 9/11. You know, you just had this regular existence and we were kind of isolated from the rest of the world as far as the suffering that everybody else had to go through. And then, mm-hmm. boom, this happens to you. And now you realize that, you know, here we are. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. So I think, you know, everybody goes through that moment where they're like, this world really, really sucks. And it begins to accumulate on you. And then mm-hmm. at that point, I think in that moment, that's when people really formulate how they're going to look at the world and how they're going to yep. live after that moment, you know, yep. the post, you know, disenfranchisement or disillusionment with the world. Mm-hmm. And so obviously I think Christianity carries a ton of utility in handling that because it's all there mm-hmm. as a nice template for you. But however you do it, you got to figure it out. Otherwise this stuff's going to consume you. Mm-hmm. Good Lord.
Plus, I think also, and we've said this before, that there's a space for saying, hey, I'm part of this problem. Like, this person is disassociating from everything around them because everything is so terrible. And then he's just conversing with himself in his own mind, but somehow thinks that he himself is not the problem. You know what I mean? Like,
right.
You're just stuck with yourself.
Right. Right.
So now you're good. The world is good now because it's just yourself. No, none of us are good. We all do stuff, you know?
Right.
So, like, that whole idea of thinking, oh, you're somehow better than the rest of the world and that, you know.
Right, he retreats into himself.
Yeah.
As if everybody else is the problem.
Right, exactly. Yeah. And that's a problem, like, when people have those mindsets.
Well, you know, there's certain forms of narcissism that are more easy to spot than others. Like, you look at a guy like Trump and you go, oh. That's easy, but this type of an attitude where everybody else is the problem and you're mm-hmm. you're this victim of the world. That's mm-hmm. that's to me that's a form of narcissism. Mm-hmm. Like you, and then the only friend that you have is yourself.
Yeah, and we saw it all the time. So
we did.
Many people thinking everybody else is the problem.
Yeah,
they themselves were not the issue.
Yeah,
you know they were struggling a little bit, but. You know.
Right, right. Well, they were struggling because other people did stuff to them.
Yeah.
So even the stuff they were doing wrong mm-hmm. was squarely at the feet of the other people who wronged them. Yeah.
You're
no.
always the victim. You gotta say, wait, there's a problem here.
Yeah. No, it's really, really true. It's true. And that doesn't, because immediately somebody's going to swing to the other side. It doesn't mean that there aren't real victims in the world and that things haven't happened.
No, but of course
if
not.
If you're the perpetual victim and if you've never hurt anyone in your life, then you're not looking at reality from an honest perspective.
And the other thing, too, is, like, that's not the solution. The solution isn't closing into your own mind and falling away from the world. The solution is if you see a problem, do something to fix that problem.
Right.
You know, you're not supposed to walk by some horrific thing that you see going on and just not do anything. We have to involve ourselves. What is that thing? About the good men stand, when good men stand by and do nothing.
Yeah, like, evil thrives when good men do nothing.
Yeah, you know.
Yeah.
We all have to actively do good in our world, huh?
Or good women.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Well, when we say it was like mankind, but.
Oh, it's good men.
That means mankind.
I don't think so.
It does. I'm telling you.
All right. Well, that's interesting. They couldn't understand what he was saying. No matter how they tried, they couldn't understand. They washed and dressed him, fed him by hand.
Yeah, and that was the other thing.
What do you mean?
Like, so all these people are terrible that are around you. Which means they're struggling.
Right.
And then you sucked into yourself and now made it so that way they have to care for you hand and foot.
Right. These terrible people.
Yeah.
Who are trying. No matter how they try, which means it looks to me like they exhausted themselves. Mm-hmm. But I think you can get to a point, so you can reach a sort of event horizon in depression where you literally are blinded to the actual people who are trying to be good to you and help you.
Yikes.
Like, you literally can't see it. Wow. So, like, this dude literally couldn't see that people were exhausting themselves, trying to help him, understand him, and then when they couldn't, they, you know, because they try to get to his soul, because they're trying to understand him.
Yeah.
And when they couldn't do that, they said, well, let's just take care of his body.
Yeah.
You know?
Yep.
They washed him and, you know, washing and dressing. Like, you read these things and it's like, oh, yeah. It's like, no. They washed him. Mm. They dressed him. Mm-hmm. They fed him. Mm-hmm. Like, those are significant things that they did for this guy. Mm-hmm. And so, obviously, you can't literalize. I mean, I'm probably not a literal person, but I mean, if you're depressed, you're struggling with depression, like, are you literally, there's nobody in your life that's attempting at all to understand you or care about you at all. At all. Mm-hmm. At all. I'm not sure about that. Mm-hmm. You know? So some of it, and that's one of my strategies when I go through my, you know, whatever, is like, try to find the ways in which people have been caring for you. And then as I sit and really think about it happens a lot. I shot a video a couple days, it was an Instagram video like a week ago or 4 or 5 days ago. I didn't say a lot. Mm-hmm. I just said, one of those days. And there was just like an outpouring of people just saying positive things. Mm-hmm. Thank you for all of you, by the way. So it's like, okay. And there's a temptation to go, nobody understands me, blah, blah, blah. And I'm a very complex individual. A lot of people, nobody understands me except for Allah. But, it's pretty cool that, you know, you do have other people that are trying. I think the effort is important. Mm-hmm. So I think recognizing that people are putting forth that effort is important. Because that's the other side of, like, trying to care for somebody who's, I mean, she could tell you, trying to care for somebody who struggles with depression is an extremely daunting task. Because they're blind to it, they can't see that they're being helped. So these guys are not getting any thank yous. They're not getting any, you did a great job. They're not getting any of that. Mm-hmm. They're just getting, this guy's in a catatonic state and then he's going to probably go kill himself or whatever. Mm-hmm. So, this guy is the subject, but the people that are caring for him, I think, are important to talk about too. And they almost never get talked about when you talk about depression. Because there's a lot of people that struggle with depression, that's true, but there's almost always somebody who's attempting to care for somebody that has depression and they never get...
Yeah.
You know.
Yep.
So. And I'd like to thank you too. Hmm? Because there's a lot of times you try to get me out of it. So. Like, hey, Vinny, hey. We'll poke here and there. Mm-hmm. So, anyway, good song. Good subject matter. What do you give the song?
Well, I think a 9 because I didn't like what we were singing about.
Wait. You gave it a 9 because you didn't like what we were singing about?
Yeah, I liked the song, but I didn't like the lyrics. Like, I didn't like... I think... You know how I rate stuff by, like, how it hits me emotionally? Like, I don't like this. I don't like somebody doing that. I don't like the person closing off to themselves.
Well, that's a pretty high score for something you don't like.
No, I liked the song. I didn't like that part of it, and that's why I knocked it down to a 9.
Oh, versus a 10.
Yeah.
This wasn't a 10 for me, but I would give it a solid 9. I think the solos pushed it up. Yeah. I mean, depression is a common theme in metal. Another thing that's interesting to me, though, is this was in the 70s, 1978, and this is some, like, straight-up metal, like, riffage and all that mm-hmm. stuff. The main riffs and stuff for the chorus were basic and simple, but if you go back to 1978, this is kind of groundbreaking. Uh-huh. And then, again, it's one of those things where you listen to an old song and you're like, oh, okay, these are where these guys got the influence. Okay.
Uh-huh.
And I'm always fascinated by Halford's vocals because I loved them. But this is actually one of the better Halford vocal performances, even though I like all of them now. So,
I like
there's
it.
That. All right, 9-9, then out.
Sorry, out.
Gone. Thank you.